For 40 days after he rose from the dead, Jesus appeared to many people, giving them convincing proof he was alive and talking to them about the kingdom of God. One day, Jesus was eating a meal with his disciples in Jerusalem. He told them that they needed to stay in the city and wait for the gift that God had promised them. John the Baptist baptized you with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. He told the disciples they would soon be given God's power to tell others about Jesus, helping people turn from their own ways and follow him. When Jesus finished speaking, he flew up into the sky right in front of his disciples and disappeared into the clouds. Suddenly, two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Why do you stand here looking up into the sky?" the men asked. "The same Jesus who was taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." So the disciples waited and prayed. 10 days later, a sound like a violent wind came from heaven and filled the house where they were gathered. Looking around, they saw what looked like tongues of fire resting on each of them. All of the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in different languages. This caused such a commotion that a crowd gathered around the house to see what was going on. Those in the crowd who were from other countries were confused and amazed, because they heard Jesus' followers speaking in their own language. But others in the crowd made fun of the disciples, accusing them of being drunk. Finally, Peter stood up to say something. Peter explained that the disciples were not drunk, but had been given the power of God's Spirit. Peter told the story of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. He challenged the people to turn away from their sins and put their trust in Jesus. That day, 3,000 people became followers of Jesus. These followers began to eat meals and pray together almost every day. Amazing things continued to happen. People were healed from sicknesses. Others sold everything they had so they could give their money to the poor. The number of people who joined them just kept growing and growing.
Some of you, that's probably the very first time you have ever sung that song. And some of you actually might say, "I hope I never sing it again." And I would hate that. I would hate that. Gene picked that song for an express purpose today. We are in session number 6 of our Bible series, all right? It's called Believe. And where we are today is on the church. We've looked at God and that God is personal and the Bible and salvation. We've looked at our identity in Christ, and today we're looking at one of the other 10 key foundational truths that we build our life on. That sixth truth is the church. In that chorus, we sang, "The church victorious one day will be the church at rest." Amen. That is an incredible truth and an incredible principle. And I hope by the end of the day today, you might say, "I want to sing that hymn again." Because you will understand it maybe better than you ever have before. That is our prayer for this Sunday morning. Let me first of all say welcome. If this is your first time to New Hope, thank you for being here on the last Sunday of September. Thank you for being here on the first rainy Sunday of the year. All right? Whoa, man, it was good. Did you hear God's voice this morning? All right. He rumbled, all right. Let us know it was time to wake up. All right? That was terrific, so thanks for being here. But if you are visiting New Hope for the very first time, in the pew in front of you, there are some visitor cards. I would love for you to take a card, fill it out. I know it's, I don't want you, you come incognito, all right? Well, we will let you leave incognito, I promise. But I'd love for you to fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. Next week through the mail, we'll send you information about New Hope. We promise. We do not beat on your door. We don't bother you on the phone. But through the mail, we'll send you information we hope that you will find informative and helpful. We have children's programs, high school, junior high, women's, men's ministries, all kinds of events going on that we'd like to see how you could be engaged in any of those. So please fill that out. Those cards are also there for our regular church folks. You have messages to the staff. You have prayer requests you would like removed from the bulletin. All kinds of things that you can do there. Fill them out, please, and put them in the offering, and we'll attend to those. A couple of announcements. Save the date, October the 24th, for the Hope Fest outdoor concert. Our worship team, plus the worship team from three other churches. Each church is going to play about a half an hour leading worship. Just be a grand time out in the parking lot. There'll be food and refreshments and activities provided as well. So put that on your calendar, 6 to 9 p.m., Friday night, October the 24th. Children's drama rehearsal today at 1 o'clock. Right, Dawn? There you are. All right, good. Right here in this building. Church golf tournament. Got two sign-up sheets here. These will go around the clipboards. There's two things on each clipboard. The top one is if you would like to sing in the Christmas choir starting a week from this Wednesday. Oh, this Wednesday, starting this Wednesday. All right. Love to have you here if you sing soprano, alto, tenor, bass. I kind of went opposite. All right. Yeah. Just seeing if you guys were awake. That's good. Yeah, sign up. We're almost to 40. We're almost to 40 voices. That's what we would love to have. So if you can carry a tune, they'd love to have you there. We can do more together than we can do singing solos, all right? So would love to have you in it. The green sheet on the bottom is to sign up for the golf tournament we have every year in October, all right? This helps out Celebrate Recovery. And you're going to hear about them in just a few minutes. But you don't have to be a professional. In fact, you don't even have to play very well at all. You would rank with most of the folks who are there. Male, female, young, old, we'd just love to have you out for the golf tournament. Sign up. You can sign up by yourself and they'll put you with a team, or you can put together your own team and play. All right. 1040, I'm not going to say much because we've talked a lot about them the last few weeks, but two things you need to know. One, we needed to raise about $3,500 more last Sunday, all right, to accomplish our goal of underwriting the needs of a village on the backside of Doropo, Ivory Coast, Africa, to help them with their educational needs that God is doing some great things with. And just to let you know, we don't need to take another offering for that today. We needed $3,500. You gave $8,000. Woo! Woo! Sunday night and Sunday morning. Sunday night 2 weeks ago, Sunday morning last week, a total of $21,000 you all gave to underwrite that. Awesome job, guys. Absolutely awesome. Some of you who are expressing interest in going on the trip in February, all right? Those applications need to be filled out this week. Go online, fill them out. Even if for some reason it changes and you cannot go, if you need to get them in by the end of this week. All right, he extended the date for us here at New Hope. Widow to Widow, a new ministry. I'm excited about this. Started by Lynn from our own church, who a brief time ago experienced the loss of her husband and discovered some challenges and needs that a widow faces that she didn't anticipate before. And so, if you have found yourself in that situation, it's a week from tomorrow night, all right, over in the Murbach building. There's more information in the bulletin, but please check that out. She'd love to have you there. We have our regular church Tuesday night and Wednesday morning women's Bible study. Also, meeting on our church grounds on Thursday morning is a Bible study fellowship women's extension class, and they have six openings left, all right? They're studying Moses, I believe, and there's more information in your bulletin and a phone number and contact. So if you would be interested in making a commitment to that study, please make that phone call. I've already highlighted the fact that we're in the midst of a 30-week series called Believe. You will notice in the church pews or in the people sitting around you, they're holding a book that looks like this. This is a Bible. It's just a little bit different than our regular Bible, all right? This one has been divided up into 30 subjects, all right, and put in the order of the study that we are doing here at New Hope. And so as you read each chapter, you are reading verses out of the Bible on that subject. How many of you read chapter 6 this week before you got here? Good job. All right. How many of you promised to get caught up by next week? Raise your hand. All right. Good, 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 good. All right. If you're new and you're interested and would like one of these, they'll be out in the pavilion after the service. The price is right. They're $10, $5 are free. You get to pick your price, all right? And so go out and get one at whatever price you choose to pay. We'd love to have it. If you're new and you'd like to get caught up with a series, you can also go to the church website and you can see the previous five services. They are there. If you missed one, catch up. If you missed all of them, take a couple of weeks, but they are there, and we will be on chapter 7 next Sunday, all right? signed a wall when you know you believe all 10, the first 10 key truths that we are studying. At whatever point you say, yes, I believe all 10 of those, go sign the wall of truth out there. All 10 of those truths are on that wall. There are pens there for you to use. Please sign them. All right, we would like to know that you identify with these 10 truths. All right, this morning is our fourth Sunday of the month, and always on this Sunday we recognize one of the ministries or missions of our church. And the one we're recognizing today is Celebrate Recovery. And so I don't want to steal his thunder in this service as I did in the last service. So without further ado, let me introduce to you our director of Celebrate Recovery, Eric Olson.
I accused Tim of stealing my thunder in the 8 o'clock service, so he's cutting it short. Before I do anything else, Scott, will you stand up and turn around? Does anybody else think Scott looks like Peter in the cartoon we watched? Peter didn't have a hat. On the golf tournament, Tim said anybody can play. They allow anybody out there. That is true. Last year, we were the there's a prize given to the team that has the lowest score, and we were given the prize. We were only the second team in. They knew no one was going to top that score. So, yeah, I think we shot 110 and cheated. anyway, today, one of the things I want to do today is we are blessed at Celebrate Recovery that each week we serve dinner from 5:30 to 6:30. And the dinners are provided by all of you. We have a sign-up sheet that's been passed around, and we have a lot of names, and we call on people, and they bring a meal, and we're able to do that. We're able to provide dinner at no charge. We have a donation can, but we're able to provide it at no charge. So I want to recognize everybody who's provided meals in the past. If we've called on you, you've provided meals or any help at all for Celebrate Recovery and the meals, will you stand up, please? I know there's a bunch of people in here. Woo. Thank you, guys. We have enough names that we're calling on people about twice a year. So if you're interested in helping us out in that area, we'd welcome that as well. So just let myself or one of the leaders that are standing over here along the wall know, and we'll add you to our list.
And about how many would they prepare for?
Right now we're feeding between 15 and 20 people each week.
Okay.
So... So our group's been going about 5.5 years. We were the original small group at New Hope. We serve dinner at 5:30. We have our large group at 6:30, which consists of a lesson or a testimony. We alternate throughout the year. And we have 25 lessons that we work through. Then we just start over. We celebrate each year an anniversary, and then we start it all over again. But one of the things we like to do is just connect with the church and let the church know that, it's not all about drug addiction and alcoholism. There's kind of an inside joke that one of the shirts that we have says, I'm one of those people. At Saddleback Church, where the ministry began, they would have ministry fairs, and all the different ministries in the church would set booths up, and people would come to the booth and say, yeah, I really want to help those people. and the reality is, every one of us is one of those people. If you can't identify with hurts, habits, or hang-ups, then you're in denial, we say. You're either in recovery or in denial. For me, myself, in Alcoholics Anonymous, they say, alcohol is really only a symptom of your problem. But what your real problem is you don't know how to live. And that's so true. For myself, my hurts began long before my alcoholism began. My dad was killed in an auto accident when I was 7. My grandmother, who was my primary caregiver, died of a stroke about 2 years later. And then I'd also seen, I was with my best friend. He had been hit by a car. Didn't know whether he was going to live. So there's all these traumas, all these things that had happened in my life that they kind of just kept me on edge. I just had this feeling that life was just, this roller coaster ride that was... I'm waiting for the next time the rug was just going to be yanked out from underneath me. And so in my family, everybody drank. So when I reached high school age, it was just natural to start drinking. And I realized, you know, when I drank, it just kind of took away, made me forget everything, and just, you know, I felt happy. And, you know, it worked for a little while, but eventually the usage of alcohol started creating a whole set of problems itself. And it took me quite a few years to turn that around. But like I said, it all started with hurts. And there's a lot of ways that we find to kind of escape the hurts. But there's one real solution. We have a creator, and he created us a certain way for an intimate relationship with him. And that's the only real healing to any of these hurts, habits, and hang-ups. So what we want to do today is just have... I'm going to show you a piece of cardboard, and it's going to be, you know, hurts, habits, or hang-ups. And then on the other side of that, I'm going to flip it over and show you what has happened in my life as part of the healing process. And each of the leaders will come up and do the same.
He's got this big one. Man.
I don't know if you can kind of see a little bit of a theme in some of the testimonies, but a friend of mine in recovery says, if you squeeze an alcoholic hard enough, a codependent pops out. And if you don't know what codependency is, just come and sit in the groups and start listening to people share. And there's a lot of different ways to define it and explain it, but it's really comes down to control. Wanting to control either others and control situations and things that we don't have control. And it's tough to learn to just trust God in all situations, especially with the things that we think we need to exert some control over, loved ones primarily. And we think it's really our duty and that we're, you know, we're not doing everything we can to help them sometimes. And really there's a line there where, you know, we just have to trust God and let him go. They're his more than their all of our loved ones are his more than they are ours, so we have to remember that. We'd love to have you come and join us. Check us out. Just come for dinner and sit through a large group. We do the lessons and testimonies and just see what we're about and see if you can find some encouragement there.
Great job, Eric. When Eric Olson first started coming to New Hope, and that's a lot of years ago, he was just beginning to explore a way out of his hurts, habits, and hang-ups. He actually got to be part of the very first Celebrate Recovery in this area at Northwest Church, and finally was at a place that he was ready to launch it here at New Hope, and we are so grateful that he has. He showed up here hurt, and he showed up here with some habits and some hang-ups. He showed up here single. And he found a lot of solutions to his problems, all right? He found faith in God, and he found the associate pastor's daughter and married her. And so Eric has done a great, great job leading Celebrate Recovery. And if this would make it easier for some of you to check out Celebrate Recovery, just show up the first night, all right, have a meal with them, go to a large group, all right, they do worship and a lesson or a testimony, and go with the idea, you know what, maybe I have something that I could offer to help them. You could be a facilitator, you could be somebody who serves, you could be somebody who runs sound. Just come with the idea, maybe you have something that you could do to help those people. That is how many of the folks who are currently leaders now started, and then after the second week, they discovered, I'm one of those people. And so then they became a participant eventually into leadership. So if that just helps you, all right, we'll let you be in denial and a codependent to start with, and then you can get it figured out. We have a few prayer requests I want to share with you. A couple that I've been handed. Thelma Chase, that is Fernwood's sister. Her service will be a week from this coming Wednesday. So not this week, but the following week. Pray for Susie Alsep. She has abdominal cancer and is undergoing treatment and needs prayer. Marilyn's nephew, Philip, he got an infection as a result of surgery on his left wrist, and that infection went to his brain. He is in a military hospital, and they say he's probably going to be in the hospital for a minimum of 6 months, maybe up to a year, while they provide treatment for him. Steve Berg continues to improve with his back surgery. Vita Bond, her health has improved because they have taken her off three medications they had her on, and she is doing much better. Diane Fletcher, Karen Lyles, continue to pray for them and their recoveries. The Angelitz family, Boitano family from our church, buried their mother yesterday. Would appreciate your prayers for them. The Actus family, most of you probably have been getting those updates. They are in Ecuador. They've basically been kicked out of Colombia until they can get their visas re-upped. And it's not that they hadn't been trying. It's just governments don't always move smoothly and orderly. And particularly in sometimes we may get frustrated with ours, but it's even worse in other places, all right? And so they are facing challenges. Here's the deal. God was not surprised by this. And I've been thinking all week, you know what? God sent Philip out in the middle of nowhere to find a Macedonian. So God may have a really good purpose for sending the Actuses to Ecuador. There may just be somebody that is in need of the message that the Actuses would love to share in Ecuador. So just be praying for them as they get those issues worked out. And then I'm going to get real personal in a prayer before we have our offering, all right? And she's sitting on the wrong side of the church from where she normally sits. She has me very confused. So I'm coming over. She's normally on the front row right side. She's backslid. She's four pews back on my left side. But this is Mary Ann. This is, and most of you know her. She's always up over there. This is, you know, last week I talked about our identity. And, you know, I used to be June Rowland's son. And, you know, then my kids were Tim Rowland's, you know, kids. And now I'm Chad Rowland's dad. Well, this is Mary Ann. And she's Lisa's mom and Milo's mother-in-law. But she's Mary Ann, all right? And she is precious. Yes, she is. And as you know, Mary Ann has been through surgery. She's been through some treatment. Been informed it looked like the cancer was in remission, all right? But that is not the case any longer. All right. She was diagnosed this Friday with stage 4 liver cancer. All right. And I am so proud of you for being here today. You are a trooper. This is a family that cries a lot. Okay. I'm surprised Lisa hasn't busted forth yet, but give me a moment or two. I'll get her there. All right. No, but this is a family that feels deeply. They care a great deal for one another. And but this is a family who has been so very much a part of my cheerleading crew. And I am so grateful that they are a part of New Hope. And so we know that from a medical perspective, what she has is going to be what takes her home to be with the Lord. It's probably a pretty good possibility. We never know what God has in store. And we can take His best. Sometimes His best is longer here. Sometimes His best is sooner there. But we can trust Him for either or. And so we are going to pray for Mary Ann this morning with the recent news that they got. And as we stand with every family that lets us in, we will stand with them during these days. So let's pray. And after this prayer, we will have our morning offering. Our Father, I love you in ways that words cannot explain or describe. Father, there are times in our life in which we face moments that we would rather not face. We know from the earliest days in church that one of these days we're going to die. The Bible tells us there's an appointment we all keep. We know that even if we don't go to church, we just try to ignore it. But Father, you didn't ignore it. You came and dealt with the problem. You sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. You sent Him to this world to live and to die and to be raised again so that, Father, we can face death without fear. You tell us we'll walk through the valley and that all we will encounter will be a shadow, for the substance of death has been removed in the resurrection of Christ. And may the shadow cause no fear in Mary Ann's life. And may the shadow create no animosity in Mary Ann's family. But Father, may we walk through the valley in the precious love of the shepherd who says, you'll enable us to rest in green pastures. You'll enable us to drink from still waters. And you will prepare a feast for us in the presence of all of our enemies. And so, Father, I pray that all that will be true in Mary Ann's experience over the weeks and months, years that you bless us with her life. And Father, when you are ready, we will trust you. We commit all this to you in the incredible name, the matchless name, the perfect name, the one who gives us hope and despair, the one who gives us joy and sadness, the one who enables us to greet every morning with an attitude of gratitude. And so we say thank you, dear Jesus. Amen and amen. Bless you, my dear.
Never tell people what they want to hear. Tell them only what they need to know. And the church is in desperate need today to hear the voice of God again. For that alone will revolutionize your life as a Christian and make it real. Not just language, but life. Never tell people what they want to hear.
Significant impact and influence in my own life, and those words are great words for us to start the message this morning. Never tell people what they want to hear. The Bible says that we live in a generation where people have itching ears and they want their ears to be scratched. They want to be made to feel good. The Scripture says never tell people what they want to hear. Major agrees with them. Tell them only what they need to know. And the church is in desperate need today to hear the voice of God again. For that alone will revolutionize our life as a Christian and make it real. This is not just language, not just church talk. This is life. Guys, my prayer has been throughout this week as God has torn my life apart and put it together again about 5 times this week. My heart's desire is that what each of us will hear in our hearts is the voice of God as He talks to us about our place in the purpose of His church in this time in history where each of us find us living. the Apostle Paul on page 89 in your Believe Bible, or in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15 in your regular Bible, says this. He says, speak the truth in love. If you speak the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head. Paul makes it very clear to us that we have a responsibility, and that responsibility is to share the truth of God's Word so that those of us who are part of His body, whatever part God has placed you to be, you might be a toenail. You might be a liver that quivers. You might be a heart that pounds life. You may be eyes or ears. You may be lips. But whatever part God has placed you in His body, all of us are to be formed not for our pleasure and not for our purpose, but we are to be formed to reflect the life of the One who is the head, and that is Jesus Christ. Let me take you to the words of the One who is our head. In the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 11 through 13, Jesus made a most interesting and maybe His most perplexing statement in all of His ministry. When Jesus starts out verse 11, He says this, believe Me. I like that. We're studying believe. So Jesus says, believe Me when I say that I am in My Father and My Father is in Me. And then He says, or if you can't believe that, if that is tough for you to get your head around, then at least believe on the evidence of the work themselves. If you can't believe what I'm saying, then believe what you are seeing. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in Me will do the works I have been doing. Okay, that's kind of mind-blowing, isn't it? Jesus is telling to His disciples, the fishermen, the tax collectors. He's saying to them, hey guys, if you can get your head and your heart around the fact that My Father is in Me and I'm in Him, and if you get your head around, can't get your head around that, then at least believe what you've been hearing Me say and do, because you're going to eventually say and do the same things I'm saying and doing. That's kind of like Joe Montana taking me out to a football field and says, Tim, just believe Me, watch what I'm doing, because in a little while, you're going to do the same thing I'm doing. And you all are going, ain't no way. I could never throw a football like he does. I could wear a pair of Hanes, maybe, like he does. But catch on. Here's what he then says. Wait a minute. He's not finished. The next thing is what's perplexing. And you will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these. Let that get a hold, let that sink in just a minute, folks. Jesus is telling us that His children, that the church, those who will believe in Christ, believe in who He is and what He accomplished, those who come after Him will do even greater things than He's done. That almost sounds sacrilegious. It sounds like I ought to be spiked out on the ground and have my eyes plucked out. These are Jesus' words. He said, believe Me. Why? How it makes this possible? Because I am going to the Father. And implied in that is when I go to the Father, the Holy Spirit will come back. The One who lives in me, the One who brings the life of the Father in me, will now bring My life into you. And I will do what you ask in My name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. As His followers, we will do the same things Jesus did, and then we will do greater. How can this be true? How is that possible? Years ago, an issue of Proceedings of the National Academy of Science reported that a super colony of ants was discovered. It stretched thousands of miles from the Italian Riviera along the coastline to northwest Spain. This was the largest cooperative unit ever recorded, according to the Swiss, French, and Danish scientists who studied this incredible phenomenon. The colony consisted of billions of Argentine ants living in millions of nests, cooperating with one another. Normally, ants from different nests will fight. Sounds a lot like folks from different churches. They will fight, but the researchers concluded that the ants in this particular super colony were close enough genetically to recognize one another. In other words, they had the same source of DNA. Laurent Keller of the University of Switzerland summed it up this way. Cooperation allowed the colonies to develop at much higher densities than normally would occur. This led to the greatest cooperative unit ever discovered. Maybe the church today needs to discover we have a similar DNA, and His name is Jesus Christ. And God has called us into one body for one purpose, and that is to offer hope to the world. Individually, we could never do greater things than Jesus. Yet just like those early followers in the first century that you read about in your chapter on the church, or you read about as you read through the book of Acts, they literally turned the world upside down. Greater things than these. In cooperation and recognition among the brothers and sisters of that first century church, they accomplished great things in the streets and around the world. And ladies and gentlemen, I wonder if you and I would let God do it again. This story of these ants along the Italian coastline adds a new twist to Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6, which says, "Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise." And maybe we as Christians need to go to the ant and consider its ways and be wise. The key question before us today is, how does God accomplish His purposes in this 21st century? In the Old Testament, God was in an ongoing relationship with the nation of Israel. And this ongoing relationship, which started with one man, Abraham, because of his faith in God. And God said to Abraham, "Out of you, I will create a nation. I will create a great nation, more than the stars in the sky and the sands of the sea." And this great nation, Israel, had a purpose. The purpose of Israel was to reveal the name of God. And the purpose of Israel was to reveal the identity of God. And the purpose of Israel was to acknowledge the plans of God to the nations. Every account written regarding Israel was intended to point people to the first coming of Jesus Christ. All of the prophecies of this book in the Old Testament, all were directed towards Christmas and Easter. We talk about the prophecy of the coming of Jesus. Let's make it easy. It's Christmas and Easter. It is the birth of Jesus Christ throughout His life that ended in His resurrection. And it is Christmas and Easter that Israel told us about, the life of Jesus Christ summed up in those two significant holy days. But after Christ came to earth, and after He did the work of the Father, the work the Father sent Him to do, after He died on the cross, after He defeated sin and death through the resurrection, after He returned to heaven, God then commissioned a new community. This was a convergence of Jews and of Gentiles coming together to share this new life they had found in Jesus Christ. And that new convergence is now called the church. The church. The Bible teaches us this church is primarily, though not exclusively, but primarily the method to be used in accomplishing God's purpose for all eternity. Today, the vital mission in this body of believers is to point people towards the fact that this Jesus who came and brought us Christmas and Easter is coming again, and that we ought to be ready. Just as they should have been preparing for His first arrival, you and I must be prepared for His last arrival. A person who embraces salvation by grace, as we discussed in session 3 in this series, the key truth of salvation. When we have received salvation through grace, we are inducted and integrated into the church as a full member of the body of Christ. While it is true a person expressing faith in Christ can gain salvation and never become an active member in God's church, but this absence of community will create a hindrance, not unlike a train that doesn't have a track or a car that has no wheels. Their identity may be in place, but there is no purpose to the relevance apart from the body. Remove my finger from my body, and it can be identified by its fingerprint as Tim Rowland's finger. But separate that finger from my body, and that finger no longer has a purpose. And separate you or me from the body of Christ, His church, and our purpose is diminished. So what's the key idea? Once we've looked at the key question, how does God accomplish His purpose today? Through the church. The key idea is this: I believe that the church is God's primary way to accomplish His purpose on earth. Paul shares with us in the book of 1 Corinthians, he uses some language regarding the human body to describe how this body of Christ works to function and to find its purpose. In chapter 12, verses 12 through 14 of 1 Corinthians, Paul wrote this: just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Jesus Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether we're Jew or Gentile, whether we're slave or free. We are all given one Spirit to drink. It's called the Holy Spirit. Not whiskey, vodka, or any other spirits. One Spirit. We were all given this one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. God says, I need all of you to be one as we go through life together. Since any belief system is just one generation away from extinction, we must ask, how are we doing today in becoming what Paul described in 1 Corinthians 12? Over the past few decades, the church at large has noticed a trend of young people walking away from church when they left their parents' home and their home church. We've also seen, though, many of them come back into the fold, kind of settling down with family and career. But today, in the last decade, there's a new trend. They're leaving. And they're not coming back as quickly. Certainly, we would all admit that the church far too often doesn't look the way Christ intended for it to look. In fact, many today readily confess to not really having a problem with Jesus as much as having a problem with His bride, the church. Then there are those in our fast-paced, breakneck speed culture who struggle to be part of a church because they just can't add one more activity to their life's list, especially if they no longer see the relevance of their time investment. And so an important part of the question for us who believe that we are part of His church on planet Earth is, does our attitudes and does our actions and does our services offer truths that are key and practices that are vital and transforming life characteristics that are so desirable that others wouldn't want to miss being here? They wouldn't want to be anywhere else but a part of this body called the Church of Christ. Are we a bride? Because remember, another term that God uses to describe the church is not only the body, but He refers to us as His bride, and that Jesus Christ is the bridegroom. And when He comes that last time, there'll be the marriage, all right, of the groom to the bride. And in the present moment, you and I are we're making preparations for the wedding day. We're getting ourselves ready to be the most beautiful we possibly could become for that moment when the groom receives us as His very own. So are we being adorned and prepared for our groom who is coming for us? Or are we mutilating ourselves? Are we becoming a grace-filled bride or a bitter one? I mean, we know sometimes marriage can make us bitter. But we haven't even got to the marriage yet, just the wedding day. Is the bride, the church, becoming bitter? Is kindness and compassion hallmark characteristics in our life, or are we known as a bride who is judgmental and harsh? Is humility and hospitality readily evident, or are we arrogant and private and selfish? Are we too busy looking at the shortcomings of others to notice our own reflection in the mirror of God's truth as it shines reality into our own life? But trends and statistics aside, in light of God's command regarding His body, there are tremendous benefits to being part of the church, this great community of believers who are daily advancing His kingdom in the world. Brings us to a significant question of application. What difference does this fact mean that I am part of His church today? What difference does this make in the way in which I live? Three things, quickly. One, in the body of Christ, we belong to a family focused on all the things of God which are good and right and healthy. Paul writes these words to the church at Philippi in the book of Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9. Brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right and pure and lovely and admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put them into practice. And the God of peace will be with you. Peace comes when our attention is on the right things and the truthful things and the admirable things. As a pastor, over 3 decades, I have met with countless people who struggle with church. As we talk and delve into their lives, I typically find one of two realities. First off, some of those folks have never truly been a part of this level of community and relationship, so they don't understand what is available and what's added to their lives. Simply put, you can't fully know what you're missing if you've never experienced it. It's like small groups, all right? I don't know until you fully experience one functioning right. You don't know what you're missing. Second issue with people who want nothing to do with church is it's a community that maybe they have been a part of in their past. And their previous church experience tore them down and caused them hurt. They need to go to Celebrate Recovery to get over church. Even if they contributed to their conflict, like most folks in CR contributed to their hurts, habits, and hang-ups. This experience with church created a physical and emotional avoidance, which is often difficult to overcome. And yet I am here to tell you, when the church functions as God intends, like the church did in Acts chapter 1, nothing else on earth works quite like the church. Christ's bride is not an organization. It is an organism. The reality of the fact is we are a church not because we are a 501c3 organized institution in the state of California. We are a church because we are the living organism of God's presence on planet Earth. It's not so much about the hype of our programs, but it's more important what the health of the people are. The church is not a building but a body. When submitted to God and serving together in true community, the church is a family that will surround people with strength and with grace while they go through tough times. The church is a family that continually points others towards the abundant life in Jesus Christ. Christians don't go to church on Sunday. I didn't stutter. Christians don't go to church on Sunday. Some of you are saying, then what in the heck am I doing here today then? Here's the deal, folks. The church, Christians don't go to church on Sunday. The church gathers to worship on Sunday. The church gathers in various places all around the world for the purpose of worship and fellowship and studying the apostles' teaching. Church doesn't happen until you and I show up at this place called New Hope. You're the church. We are the church. And we gather together for the purpose of worship and study and fellowship. And seekers sometimes will come on a Sunday morning to a place that we call church to discover who the church really is and what do they have that I might need. In reading chapter 6 this week, I was seized by a vision of what the church could be if all of us would be led by God's Holy Spirit. If we could let God do again in us what He did in that first century church. I was reminded of a quote that Bill Hybels has coined and made famous over the last few years. He says, there is nothing like the church when it's working right, because the local church is the hope of the world. When some of you first walked into this building the very first time, what you were looking for was not stained glass windows or a worship band. What you came in those doors looking for was hope. And you don't find hope, though it says it on one of those windows that I think is covered up at the moment, which is the way sometimes our Christian life is. We have the shades down. Oh me. They came to see hope, and they find it. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Bill Hybels tells a story in one of his books about being 13 or 14 years old, riding in a car with his dad. His dad had been one of the principal founders of the church that he grew up in. He'd been a charter member and probably the single biggest financial contributor to all the construction projects and the growth of the church over the years. But Bill, growing up in that church, and though he had plenty of friends and everybody liked him in the church, it was a harsh, judgmental, critical church. Very legalistic. And one day, driving down the road, his dad asked him, he said, Bill, he said, one of my dear friends I work with a lot is in desperate need. He needs God, and I've been thinking about inviting him to church. And Bill said, oh, Dad, don't do that. You'll ruin him. And I wonder how many folks have that similar attitude. Oh, no, we can't. We need to get him introduced to Jesus, but we don't want to take him to church, because church would ruin them. In the body of Christ, we will grow healthier in our walk with God. Point number two, in the body of Christ, we will grow healthy in our walk with God. Certainly we can grow spiritually all on our own, but when we join in and get in step with a body of believers, it can make healthier our growth through accountability and an interesting word called synergy. Accountability simply means everybody in the group has each other's back. Everyone is encouraged to grow and mature together. This communal expectation assumes we will grow. You've joined a team with a clear goal and motivation for each individual member's success. I can just tell you about our small group. I'm just a part of it. I'm not the leader. Our fearless leader is sitting right back there. She does a great job. But I can tell you about our small group. I can tell you of men in that small group who wouldn't pray out loud, who would not read out loud, who would not share a prayer request, who would not make an application to anything we were studying the first couple of months we were together. And I can tell you that those men now pray out loud, and those men are willing to accept responsibility and lead a small group and direct questions. It wasn't forced on them, it wasn't made. But in that group, in that culture of mutual accountability and safety, they have grown and matured. Probably wouldn't have happened all by themselves. And then synergy. Synergy means the cohesion of the group is a greater force than the individual sum of the members. Together they produce an overall stronger result than if each person were to work alone towards the same goal. As the writer of Ecclesiastes teaches about this in chapter 4, verses 9 and 10, two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either one of them falls down, they can help the other one up. But pity anybody who falls and there is no one there to help them up. The Calgary Stampede, it's been known for many years as one of the premier rodeos in the world, just right below the Clovis Rodeo. One of the most exciting and anticipated events is the heavy horse pull. We don't have that one here. The story is told of the year when a horse pulled 9,000 pounds and the second place horse pulled 8,000 pounds. At the end of that event, those two owners got together, put their two horses together, decided to see what the horses could do together. Teamed up, just logic would tell us they ought to be able to pull about 17,000 pounds, right? They pulled 30,000 pounds together. 9 and 7, 16, they'd almost double what they could do by themselves. The law of synergism caused the combined action to be greater than the sum of the efforts of working alone. Oddly enough, it's like saying 1 plus 1 equals 3. But actually, this is not addition. Synergy is multiplication. It is saying God and me and you equal turning the world upside down. That is synergy. In the body of Christ, number three, we become a part of a movement that is larger than ourselves. Studies from the millennial generation, whose birth years range from 1980 to 2000. Let me pause just a moment. If you were born between 1980 and 2000, would you raise your hand? Just rate 1980, 2000. Raise them high. Raise them. Don't be bashful. Okay, good, 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 good. About 25 of you. Good. We need more in that age group. All right? But that's good. That's good. Here's the deal about those folks. Those people. That age group reveals the importance and the power of relationship. While these people represent the least religious generation in American history, they also deeply value service to others by working together. What at first glance might seem to be bad news for the church may actually turn into a powerful motivator for involvement and engagement in ministry. Thankfully, God knows exactly the dynamics of each generation and also what it takes to engage them in His kingdom. If we could just wake up with a different focus in the morning, how different our life might be. I wonder how many people wake up in the morning saying, why isn't this world making me happy? This approach to life is not going to be satisfying and fulfilling for the long haul. But when we engage in the church as God intended the church to be, when we see ourselves as part of a far larger plan and purpose than our own, then we are infused with the power of eternity. We can indeed accomplish those greater things that Jesus promised. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, bottom of page 92, top of page 93, and believe, Jesus is having this dialogue with Simon Peter. And he's saying, Peter, who do people out in the city streets say that I am? And then he comes down to the real heart of the issue. Peter, who do you say that I am? And Peter, to the astonishment of everybody, said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus looked at him and said, Peter, you're not smart enough to figure that out on your own. Flesh and blood, he said, has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven has. And then Jesus made a prophecy. Jesus said, Peter, upon this truth that you've just declared, a key truth, upon this rock I will build my church. Upon this truth that I am who I said I am and that I would do what I said I would do upon that truth, you along with others will engage with me in building the church. And then he made a promise. Upon that promise and that prophecy, the gates of hell will not prevail. What gives us confidence today that the church will outlive and outlast every other organization, dynasty, and empire that this world has ever seen? What gives us the confidence who is building it, who is sustaining it, who's protecting it, who's regenerating it, who's recreating it from age to age? To say the church is not what it used to be, thank God. And the church today is not what it will be, thank God. Because he knows what is necessary to get to each age. And the question for you and I to ask is this: are we allowing God to do in us what this age needs? Could God turn the world upside down again through his church? If you and I let Jesus be the source of his own dynamics, this Jesus who is the Son of God and God the Son, the second person of the Trinity, the Savior of the world, the sustainer of the church until the end of time, then we have nothing to worry about. Almost 40 years ago, sitting in a classroom, Bill Hybels was listening to Dr. Brandt talk about this passage of Scripture when Jesus said, I will build my church. Listen to what the professor said. Students, you do realize that this is the only thing Jesus is doing between his ascension and his return. This is the only thing that Jesus is doing. Jesus is not directing the angelic choir. They're singing just fine without him. He's not fretting about the planets spinning out of their orbits. They're behaving very nicely. He's not taking long naps or doing crossword puzzles. He's full-time, focused attention, 24/7, building his church because that is the hope of the world. He's building in Singapore and Sydney and Mumbai and Mexico City and Shanghai and Chicago and Colombia and Doropo, Ivory Coast. He knows that this is the hope of the world. And please understand, if you take nothing else away from this talk, please understand that one of the greatest privileges in all of life is when Jesus taps you on the shoulder. Moses at 80, Jonah in rebellion, David as a young teenager, Lydia as a businesswoman, and the woman at the well as a mess. And he tapped him on the shoulder. Please understand that one of the greatest privileges is when Jesus taps us on the shoulder and says, "Hey, Phil. Hey, Pam. Hey, Teddy. Hey, Ashley. I have a critical role for you to play. I have a critical role for you to play in the building of my church because you are the hope of this world. Part of the reason I've called you to myself to have a relationship with me, part of the reason I redeemed you from sin and I gifted you with your gifts and I filled you with my Spirit and I prepared you with the dings and the bruises that you've had in your life was so that you could step into this particular church for this particular role to build the hope of the world. Will you do it? I need you. Will you join me?" I remind you this morning, church is the hope of the world. If you have ever felt that kind of tap on your shoulder, and I have, if you have ever grasped the enormity of God's Son, the Savior of the world, inviting you and your brokenness and me with mine, in each of us with all of our hang-ups, to join Him in the building of His church for the glory of the world, how in God's name do you say no? It's still one of the great mysteries of my life. How do sincere Christ followers say no when God taps us on the shoulder and He has a role for us? How does a Christian say, "Hey, Jesus, I know you're really busy building your church, and I understand you've invested a lot into me to offer me the hope of the world, but I'm a little busy right now with my own stuff. I've got my career, my reputation, my net worth, my retirement. So you go ahead, you do your thing, Lord, and I'll do mine." Don't be that guy. Choose today. Don't be that woman. Don't be that student at school that cops out. Be part of what makes a difference in this world. The morning prayer of every sincere believer in Christ on planet Earth ought to be something like this. Oh, Jesus, this new day I freshly commit to you the role that you've invited me to play as you are building your church in the world. Jesus, I'm awestruck in these dawn hours that you are inviting me into this grand, life-giving, world-transforming enterprise. So today, Jesus, today I give you my love, I give you my heart, I give you my talents, I give you my bruises, I give you my creativity and faithfulness and my gratitude. I commit all of myself to you, Lord, and to the role that you want me to play in building your church. I'll bring it today, Lord, I'll bring it tomorrow, and I'll bring it the day after tomorrow. I will bring it for your glory, and I'll bring it for the sake of the world who needs it. You're mine and I'm yours, Lord. Do what you want. Can you imagine if 2 billion people in the world who claim to be Christians prayed that prayer every morning and meant it? Holy smoke! Closer to home, can you imagine if 600 or 700 Christ followers who toss around the word New Hope and say it's their home? What would happen to this church if every believer in it prayed a prayer like that every morning and we meant it? The gates of hell would melt in front of us. The church would prevail in ways that would be written about. We would see demonstrations of God's presence in ways that we couldn't believe. And Jesus says to you and me today, as he did in the Gospel of John, "Believe me, for you will do the same thing I've been doing and even greater works than these. So today, I call you unapologetically. I am calling you to full devotion to Christ. I'm calling you this morning unapologetically to forfeit lesser dreams. I am calling you unapologetically to give the best of the rest of your life, the best of your creativity and effort and talents and gifts and resources to this one thing that human history is depending upon, the local church, the hope of the world. It's so important we don't forget the purpose for which we were built. With this, I'll close. Shah Jahan built the Taj Mahal, and he built it as a beautiful building to house the remains of his wife. It started out as a simple place, and now all of us know one of the wonders of the world, the Taj Mahal. Here's the problem, though. Shah Jahan got so caught up in the building, he forgot about its purpose. One day, going from one side of the construction site to the other side of the construction site, his robe brushed up against a wooden box and got dust all over it. It made him mad. He yelled for one of the workers to come, "Get rid of that box, get it out of his way." He did not know until days later the box that he had removed from the premises was the box that contained the remains of his wife. He built a building, but he lost his purpose. We don't exist, folks, as a church so people can say, "What a great building this is." We don't exist so that people can say, "What a great bunch of people you are." We exist so that people can look at us and say, "What a great God they serve." You want to be part of that? Then unapologetically, I call you to full devotion this morning. Unapologetically, I ask you, forfeit lesser dreams. And unapologetically, I'm asking you, give the rest and the best of your life to Him. Are you willing to do that? Then pray with me. Our Father, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that maybe there have been seasons of my life I have failed to give you the best of what you've given to me. I'm sorry that maybe even part of that may have been similar to Shah Jahan. And that is, in building a church, I lost sight of building your church. So, oh God, bring to fruition and reality in our lives here. We cannot be accountable for anybody anywhere else, but be accountable to you for here. That I give you the rest and the best of my life so that you can do greater things than I could ever imagine. Not for any glory or benefit of my own, but Father, for the hope of the world. Thank you for hearing any and all of our prayers today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Have a great day, guys. Hope you're here next week.